Good morning to everyone. Sam Fleming from the Financial Times. I've been covering the US economy for about a year and a half now, and I think it's fair to say economists tend to disagree on most things. The productivity story I've discovered over the past year and a half in the US is one which has really triggered a bewildering array of different explanations and real puzzlement amongst policymakers I speak to. It's a really huge issue, as Rob says, and a really fascinating one as well. So let me introduce our panel so we can talk about these issues and hopefully reach some sort of consensus on what the problems are and potential solutions. To my immediate left is Donald Marron, who's Director of Economic Policy Initiatives at the Urban Institute, formerly an acting director at the Congressional Budget Office. To his left is Stephen Cohen, who's the co-director of the Berkeley Roundtable on the International Economy, co-author with Brad DeLong recently of a book, Concrete Economies, The Hamilton Approach to Economic Policy and Growth. And finally, Martin Neil Baily, Brookings. He's the Bernard Schwartz Chair in Economic Policy Development there and former chair of the Council of Economic Advisers under Bill Clinton. I'm going to start with Martin on my far left, if I could. Martin, could you help? Rob's done a brilliant job of framing this debate, but I'd be grateful if you could give us your, in a sense, top five explanations as to why productivity growth in the US is so poor at the moment. Is it basically down to a story of poor investment, or are there a range of factors that you would cite?
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me to be here. It's a great pleasure. My top five. Okay, well, number one, I think investment has been weak. There's a chicken and egg problem with investment. Of course, if we can get growth going, you tend to get more investment. If you get more investment, you get productivity. But it's hard to push investment if the overall economy is not growing faster. But certainly, I would name investment, lack of investment, as one of the reasons we have slow productivity growth. The second one is sort of Robert Gordon's view, which is that we've run out of innovation. There was a nice big box of innovation, and we opened it up somewhere in the early years of the Industrial Revolution, and we started pulling them out one by one, or two by two, and now we kind of run out, and we've run out of the biggest innovations. And we had a sort of last gasp from 1995 till about 2004, which was the surge of IT investment and the related improvements in productivity that went with that. But now we're really stuck in a crawl because there's not that much innovation out there. The third, and I guess I'd attribute it somewhat to Larry Summers, is it's the Great Recession. We're still having the lingering effects of the Great Recession. Of course, that can be linked to the weakness of investment, but I think Larry's sort of secular stagnation view is also that this has impacted the sort of ability of companies to make improvements. So somehow what we would need to do in that case is to try to step up aggregate demand, push the economy forward, and then we'd maybe get more on the productivity side. And then I'd mention the idea, and I think it was essentially mentioned by Rob Atkinson, which is that, well, there is a lot of innovation out there. It's just that it takes time to bring that innovation into business processes and into industries. And so if we stick around, all this great stuff we hear about in biotechnology, now we can eliminate mosquitoes if we want to. Maybe some of those things are scary, but some of those things surely have the potential to change the way our economy operates and the way what business does. And so it's just a question, and Eric Brynjolfsson at MIT is kind of leading spokesman of this view, that we need to do more investment, we need to do more R&D, but over time, we will get another increase in investment. I'm not sure if that was five, but I'll stop there.
Very good list. Thank you very much. Stephen, can I ask you also, maybe frame it slightly differently, why is it so important, productivity? Why do we care so much about productivity?
Productivity is...
Need to hold your, the microphone. Sorry.
Just talking to it, I think.
It's on.
It's on. Good. Well, most fundamentally, productivity is what increases the value of your work, what you get out of it. How you divide it up, who gets it, is typically treated by economists as a second question, although the two tend to relate very tightly. And we've gone over these lists of reasons for failing anemic productivity gains in the United States and weak, weak investment. Rob Atkinson's and the ITIF staff report, I think, is a very good list. Mr. Baily added a few good ones. I certainly am a strong believer that an increase in overall demand might just spur an increase in investment, because if you look out the window and demand is not growing, why the hell invest? All that said, and it was said so well, I don't want to repeat it. There are the others. You know, Rob Atkinson was pointing out that we have a very weak public sector investment in all the important domains. I took the train down from New York to re-experience the infrastructure problem. I took the fastest train in the country. It managed 73 miles an hour. I had my laptop out. I couldn't do anything on it. It was shaking and bouncing and pathetic. I'd love to get a hold of a 1952 or 1958 railway timetable to see how we've improved things. So we have very low public investment. Everyone knows about our crumbling infrastructure. Everyone knows we're not putting it into science and development work. Everyone knows our teachers are not doing as well as they should. This is not news, but this is a willful political choice on our part. It is not something that is happening to us. It is something we are doing to ourselves. And probably most of this problem will be traced back to dysfunctioning markets guided by malfunctioning politics, if you really have to put a finger on it. And the low private investment has multiple reasons. I said demand, income distribution, which shifted so much of the income, let's say, to the top 1%, who are trying valiantly with great effort to spend the damn stuff, but there's no way they can keep up. So we have a weakening of demand there. We were told earlier about the corporate behavior aiming at the quick return with corporate Wall Street incentives to companies not to invest but to buy back with the super cheap money they can borrow, and also corporate executive incentives to do just that. And then investments, when they are made, are increasingly perhaps being made offshore. In 2014, the auto guys finally started to invest, and we invested $10 billion in the auto sector in the United States, but $7 billion in Mexico. So that's another one. The other one mentioned was the nature of modern investment. It's light and cheap. You know, you can buy a cheap computer and do just about everything on it. So maybe the dollar value of investment is not quite as revealing as it might. Also, we're going for a low-wage, low-cost economy. Low-wage workers don't prompt investment. High-wage workers do. Anyhow, let me add one more. This is a list we've all gone over. You can pick and choose. In just what has growth consisted in the last, let's say, 20 years? What is its substance? Concretely, what did we add to the economy as well as remove? And we cut manufacturing out of the economy. I find units like $100 billion or $400 billion utterly meaningless. But by two pentagons of hunk, That's a good-sized unit, a Pentagon. We reduced that out of our economy. Presumably, it was all flab and things of the past, like machine tools, automobiles, consumer electronics, as they were once quaintly called. And we added, through direct public policy, big growth sectors, the industries of the future. We added finance, the processing of health insurance claims, and commissions on real estate transactions. We added a full Pentagon of these things to replace what we liposuctioned out. This was the implant. And we now have an economy where about 20% of GDP are those three items. Pushing health insurance claims back and forth and back, not counting the work you do at home on it. Real estate transaction commissions and finance. I would offer the hypothesis that all of these, the increase, the full Pentagon worth of GDP increase in these added zero value to the economy. So how can you deal with the productivity when the output is zilch? And this is a real question. We used to worry about these things years ago about the public sector. What is the productivity of the State Department when you can't value the output? All you can value measure is throughput. Is it more treaties signed, fewer treaties signed, more wars, less? It's a very troubling question. And we've added this huge hunk to our economy. And I, for one, am hard-pressed to see what the actual value added was.
Donald, let me ask you about the, why don't you pick up that last point? I mean, are we effectively in the U.S. producing the wrong things? Is the economy skewed in a way away from increasingly productive industries and towards churn and other sectors which perhaps don't register so much value added?
So again, it's a great pleasure to be here, and congrats to ITIF on its 10th anniversary. You know, clearly, if you look at the stats, the U.S. economy looks unusually skewed towards finance. And at various moments in its recent history, it seemed unusually skewed toward housing. From a policy point of view, if you wanted to ask what form of investment our tax system and our government system encourages the most, right, it's clearly the construction and financing of houses, where you could make a good argument that that is not the optimal place for the marginal investment dollar to go. So we've ended up in a place where kind of the mix of economic activities we're pursuing seem off. We're also obviously going through this transition where we have the aging of the population, we have various changes going on out there, and so we have a greater focus on healthcare, expanding focus on education. There's a longstanding debate about whether productivity growth in those sectors can be as fast as it is in manufacturing or in IT, those kinds of sectors. Some of you may remember the notion of Baumol's disease, which used to be, you know, if we had this conversation 10 years ago, people probably would have mentioned it already. And so there's an issue about kind of the composition of things we do in the U.S. economy today and whether it's going to be able to sustain and generate the level of productivity growth we aspire to. I just wanted to, this being Washington, I'm allowed to pivot. So I wanted to pivot back to your earlier question to Steve about the importance of productivity. And this is probably preaching to the choir, because I suspect you're all pro-productivity, pro-growth, pro-higher living standards people. But at least, so I'm like, you know, card-carrying an economist, and so I tend to say things like, it'll lead to higher living standards and hope that, like, that sways everybody. But in preparing for today, I did go check out a book called The Moral Consequences of Economic Growth by Benjamin Friedman at Harvard. It's about 10 years ago. And I did just want to share a quote from it about the importance of productivity growth. He frames it in terms of economic growth, but it's the same thing for productivity growth. So just bear with me. Economic growth, meaning a rising standard of living for the clear majority of citizens, and this is a point that Steve raised that we should come back to, is you want to make sure that this is inclusive, more often than not fosters greater opportunity, tolerance of diversity, social mobility, commitment to fairness, and dedication to democracy. But when living standards stagnate or decline, most societies make little progress towards any of these goals. In all too many instances, they retrogress. And at least to me, that resonates a bit with some of the things we're seeing in American politics and discussions today, that if there's a perception of stagnation, some tendencies in various parts of the American polity are troubling, and that you shouldn't think, rising living standards is just not a matter of you having, you know, a second, you know, fancy refrigerator in your home, or bringing up people from poverty, the second obviously being incredibly important. But it's also about sort of putting us on a trajectory where people perceive that, you know, their kids' lives will be better off, that society's making progress, and kind of fostering, if you believe the Friedman hypothesis, fostering a culture that's more tolerant, more diverse, more open to democracy. In business, this is sometimes summarized, of course, down to a bumper sticker, right? And the bumper sticker would be, if you're not growing, you're dying. And that feels to me, you know, you could debate the details of that, but it feels to me to be right, and that we should view encouraging productivity growth, encouraging investment in this larger context, that it's, you know, raising living standards plus a lot of spillover benefits for the society we live in.
There, I mean, there is a perception, though, isn't there, that even in periods when there have been relatively decent productivity growth in the past few decades, living standards, wages have not been rising enough, that workers have not been sharing the fruits of that increased productivity. So how do you address that argument? Is that a misperception, or is there a disconnect?
Well, so I think in the 90s, there was a clear correlation of booming economy benefiting many, unemployment rate getting low, right, wages and compensation rising. That's less clear in the data in the past decade or so. And part of that is, you know, we can go full on geek here if we want about how productivity is measured and how wages are measured and various interesting things to economists about, well, you really ought to measure compensation, not wages, and you really ought to measure inflation correctly in the both series and go through those kinds of things. And my reading of the evidence is that if you do all of the technical calculations correctly, it is still likely the case that overall compensation is growing with overall productivity if you measure everybody in the economy, but it's very skewed. And so that's not working for the average American worker, and that one of the things we need to get back on track on is to make sure that the gains we have from sort of an expanding pie are shared in such a way that, as Friedman put it, that you want a clear majority of the citizens to be feeling it.
Martin, do you want to add anything to that?
Well, you're right. You've identified a serious issue, which is the widening of the income distribution, much higher share going to profits, and within labor income, the median and below, or even a little above the median, hasn't done very well. What do we do about that? I think in other countries, in European countries, they do much more income redistribution than we do. And there are advantages to that and potential disadvantages to that. I think there has been a lot of skill bias technical change. That is to say that if you have conceptual skills, if you have social skills, ability to interact or lead people, you do very well. Obviously, if you can dunk a basketball, you do very well. So there are certain skills that are rewarded very highly in our marketplace, but the sort of regular guy, not just the guys, both genders, are not necessarily doing so well. So it, you know, obviously we can talk about improving the education system. That's a tough thing to do. I think it has to be done. But the problem is really quite acute. We also have perhaps more, there's argument we have more monopoly profits now than we used to, and I think you can make that case. You know, there were quite a lot of monopoly profits back in the 50s and 60s too, so I don't think it's exactly a revolution. And even the companies that are sort of monopolies, the Googles and the Apples of this world, sort of have to keep running or else their competitors will come up behind them. But nevertheless, it's the case. That the income distribution is shifted away from labor and towards profits in the last many years. So we're not getting an even distribution of the productivity we're getting. It's a funny kind of thing, and my friend Robert Lawrence always says, you know, so much bias and so little technical change, in the sense that we seem to be getting a labor force which is helping the people at the top much more at the bottom, and we sort of think that's got something to do with technology. But if that's the case, why aren't we seeing more overall productivity growth? So I think there's still a lot of puzzles around that. But certainly the outcome we see, which is slow productivity growth and continued widening of the income distribution, that's not a great outcome we're facing. And by the way, I think more investment would help that. So my reading of Thomas Piketty's book is that we got too much investment, and that's driving down the share of labor income. I actually think he's got the sign wrong. I think we need more investment to help workers. That's what historically has helped wages.
Stephen, let's talk about investment then. At the dinner we had last night, someone observed that an awful lot of investment at the moment by companies at the high-tech end seems to be going into apps and other, you know, arguably developing stuff which maybe doesn't represent a quantum leap forward in innovation. Do you think there is any truth in that? Do you think companies are investing somehow in the wrong stuff? And that innovation itself is beginning to stall a little in the States, or do you think that that it's a question of waiting for this innovation to start showing in the productivity numbers?
I don't at all go along with Robert Gordon's idea that we had these fabulous inventions starting in the 1880s, and we kind of used up the fruit on that in the 1970s, a good 100-year run. Nor do I accept the idea that the kind of innovations we're having now, that I can go look something up on Google, it's not priced properly. Because innovations, when we had the huge innovations, radio, then television, well, it was priced the same way Google's priced. It came in through the ads. And then we had innovations, the sock vaccine, the end of polio. This was considered by most mothers the greatest invention in the history of the earth. And this was negative for GDP, as were antibiotics. We had a, just imagine if we had a proper medication for cancer. It would be a blow to one of our largest industries. So this goes on all the time. But what also went on all the time in this country is government would take a lead and open a new economic space and encourage entrepreneurs to run in and innovate and grow and transform it beyond anything anyone had imagined. And
give us some examples. I mean, at least one good example
number,
of that.
Pick a number from 1880 to now, to 1980, from 1780 to now. Hamilton, okay, my favorite. Hamilton looks out the window and says, what an economy. This is a colonial operation. You Brits had the whole thing organized. We send you beaver skins and timber from the New England forests, tobacco from the Chesapeake, and cotton from the slave plantations. And you send us, thank you very much, manufactured goods and the high-end services, including the shipping and insuring. So Hamilton says, what are we going to do about this? We got to tilt the playing field. None of this level playing field. So we slapped on a huge tariff and kept it, by the way, till close to World War II. We were the high tariff nation in what we would now call the North Atlantic. Hamilton had other uses for those tariff revenues that perhaps the Eurozone could figure out how to take the debts and consolidate them the way Hamilton did and build a strong state, etc. Another time, the Republicans in the late 19th century. We need railways. Government's got to take the lead. If nothing else, you need a right of way. Government is going to finance this, but we were small government. We didn't write many checks, though we wrote a few good ones. Instead, we gave them the land along the railway in checkerboard patterns. We gave the American railway private companies to build the private infrastructure more land than there was in England. It was really rather a lavish grant. Or another way, the Congress looks out and said, we have public assets. It's now called the Middle West. It was all government land. I'm going to turn it over. I'm going to privatize it. I would suggest of the 3,296 economists in Washington practicing currently.
Oh, why are you picking on me?
All but two. You were the dean of the economists for a while. All but two would say, let's have an auction. And then they'd split up. One has a Dutch auction, another one has one with a randomly generated, all kinds of great auctions. The Congress thought of it. These guys understood an auction and said, no way. We don't want that. We are not selling it to the highest bidder. That'll bring us latifundia and slavery. And then a mass of landless laborers, the damn place is gonna look like Argentina or Latin America. Nope, we gave it to small holdings with a proviso. We entailed it, and you had to sit on that hunk of land. That's why we don't have villages the way civilized countries do. How lonely house on a lonely prairie, one after the next.
Let me introduce. Interrupt. Sorry. So Donald, can we take that forward to current government policy then? How significant do you think the decline, for example, in public R&D spending is for this productivity story, this lack of productivity we're seeing now? How big a role does public policy now need to take, and specifically public spending, in order to turn this story around?
Sure. So let's do big picture about how budgeting works in the United States and how it's changed over the decades. So if you went back 50 years ago and you were a member of Congress, you would come in and you'd be in a situation where even if the budget was in deficit that year and there was a little bit of pressure to tighten your belt, if you looked several years in the future, things always looked rosy. And the reason why is that most spending was discretionary, and so there wasn't a built-in baseline of upwardly increasing spending. And tax revenues, the design of the tax system was such, if you go back 50 years ago, it wasn't even indexed to inflation, that if you looked out a few years in the future, there would be a lot more tax revenues. And so even if you had a temporary deficit at the moment, when you came into office and you were thinking about what you could do, including investing in the future, you had plenty of fiscal room to do that in most years. You could feel comfortable about doing it, and it was sort of your job, right? Your job was, hey, in a couple of years, if not immediately, we're going to be in good fiscal situation, and I have to figure out what to do with those resources and choose a mix of investing in the future and reducing taxes. You then jet forward to today, and the situation's really different. The majority of the budget is now mandatory spending, things like Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, several other programs. The general tendency of those cumulatively is to rise faster than the share of the economy. Tax revenues are within orders of magnitude, kind of roughly the same size relative to the economy as they were back in the day. They don't rise as fast as you look out ahead. And so when you come in today, there isn't that fiscal space to say, you know what, a new opportunity has arisen, we should be making more investment. I mean, the opportunity obviously is still there, but the fiscal space and ease of doing that is much harder. And so, you know, from a kind of a grand budgeting point of view, the world in which we need to get is one where the balance of future spending, future tax revenues is such that members of Congress feel like one of the things they are encouraged to do by their constituents and can do within the constraints of our budget process is to also look for the opportunities for where investment is needed. And clearly, for all the reasons Rob started us out with, there's clearly a need for more of it.
What, in absence then of fiscal action, why is monetary action not spurring the kind of investment we want to see? Because we do have monetary levers, even if we don't have fiscal ones, and yet they don't seem to be spurring the kind of things we want to see, the productivity upsurge that we want to see either.
Yes, I mean, the quick answer would be, so you always have this challenge when you're looking at the macro, sort of what level of interest rates are, is how much of that is actually because of monetary policy and how much because the world economy is broken. And I would say a significant chunk of that is the world economy is broken, although the Fed may have done some things to bring down longer rates. But then, you know, you got to pivot back to the issues that Rob raised at the beginning, which is that there are a variety of types of investment, R&D being the classic one, but it's also true for some kinds of physical investment, certainly true for infrastructure, where there are spillovers. And that just, you know, calibrating the right interest rates, suppose the Fed is perfect and it calibrates the right interest rates to kind of get macro policy right, there's still a role for the government to step in, identify the areas where there are positive spillovers and try to encourage those.
Well, it seems likely, and many people have said this, seems likely in the next 4 years or the next presidential administration, we're going to face a recession. And monetary policy has a little bit that it can do. So that leaves fiscal policy really as the only tool. And given our political the deadlock, it's hard to do anything about that. But the thing we maybe could do and that we should be planning to do right now so that we have it ready to do is a substantial infrastructure program. That we can waste money on that, but we can also do very productive things with infrastructure. Certainly, I was in Europe recently, I was actually in Australia recently, they don't have everything in their economies right, but boy, the roads are a lot better than they are here. It's just crazy that a rich country, the head of FedEx, I was at some meeting, and he was complaining about the roads and saying, we need to fix the roads. Well, of course, it's his trucks that are damaging the roads, but at the same time, we should be fixing the roads and the infrastructure. I mean, why aren't we doing it? Why do we have a third world power grid? Aren't we doing more towards water management? So we've got low interest rates. We clearly, I think, will need to stimulate the economy if we don't already. So let's have the right plan to do it. High-speed trains, I'm not so sure about, but there are plenty of great things we could do. And the trouble with our train system is that it's designed for freight, and it does that very well. And it's sort of difficult to mix freight and passenger. It can be done, but that's one of the reasons we haven't been able to do better on freight. But mass transit, we could do more on. There are lots of ways we could spend productively on infrastructure.
I'm going to take one point from Stephen and then open it up to the audience for questions. So when you ask a question, please do say who you are, and we'll first take one point from Stephen.
I want to go back to this idea of the government opening up a new economic space. It does not have to do this through spending. If we accept this premise that we can't spend, a premise I don't particularly accept, but for the moment, infrastructure. We built the New York subway privately. We built the American railway system privately. The French built their highway system, those beautiful highways that cross France, privately. Now, of course, the government was there with the contract. So all you're doing is the government takes, okay, I'll back up this risk somehow or help subsidize the loan, the private developer, and then we're happy. We have gotten around the impasse. And the government has to open up these sectors. We did it most recently, the same way we opened up railways, the same way we opened up manufacturing in Hamilton. We opened up a new sector called finance. This was deliberate public policy. We cleared away the shackles that were binding this industry, that were set in place for a determined purpose. And sure enough, we got innovation galore, because it's real easy to innovate in finance. We got growth, but we picked a loser as an industry. That doesn't mean we have to stop. We had a good record for over 200 years. And this one was wrong because we did it the wrong way. We did it out of a combination of ideology and theory. Whereas all the other reshapings of the economy did, what do we want here? What do we need? How do we get this? What's it going to look like? And if we would go back to discussing what we want to do with this economy. Everyone here has mentioned infrastructure. Okay, it's an appalling mess. Let's get started on that. People can understand that. We can find ways of financing it, and not a big deal. I'd go further to the other kind of infrastructure, otherwise known as investment, and the replacement of our lost technologies. Starting my favorite list is antibiotics. But we could all put together a very reasonable list of what we need. And without having to get in a struggle, does it have to be just spontaneously thrown up? Anyhow, I've spoken too much.
Well, no, that's fine. One question before we do go to the audience, Donald, if I could ask you, is on tax reform. How potent do you think tax reform could be in terms of sparing, particularly we've spoken a lot about public sector investment, spurring private sector investment? The points that Rob was making earlier, do you see potential there?
So, I mean, there's definitely potential. I don't want to oversell tax reform as a magic bullet, but it's clear that we have a tax system that no one would design intelligently or intentionally.
Be a little stronger.
Also true intentionally, but no one.
Be a bit stronger, Don. I think the system's terrible. It would make a big difference if we reformed it.
Hear, hear.
It really would.
Well, I'm trying to calibrate. When you think about the tax system, there's kind of three things you want to think about. So one is the rest of the world versus U.S. set of issues. And obviously, you don't want the tax system to encourage investment to be abroad. You'd rather have it be here. There's sort of a level issue of how high taxes are and what that implies about the level of investment people are willing to undertake. And then there's the distribution, right? How are you taxing different types of investment differently? And are you doing that in an intelligent way that's possibly correlated with the spillovers they generate, or are you doing it in an arbitrary way? And I would say our system at the moment is skewed towards the arbitrary. So again, obviously, the thing that is most favored from an investment point of view in the tax code at the moment is housing. That strikes me as insane. I'll take Martin's advice and be more colorful.
Good.
That just, you know. The favoritism for debt over equity, I find also to be quite troubling, particularly when you think about a lot of innovative firms in the world are ones that if you're investing in R&D, you often tend to rely a little more on equity financing rather than debt, and there's no reason to have a tax system that's going to discourage you from doing that. So that makes no sense. And then there are just sort of arbitrary distinctions among industries as a result of the interaction of the myriad of provisions in the tax code, and I think you ought to just, you know, tear those all up and revisit them. And then you also face a deep fundamental issue that I think divides people when they think about business tax reform or corporate tax reform is when you get down to the details from an investment point of view, there are kind of two strategies you can go with, right? One is to focus on the rate and say 35 is way too high and by international standards, we need to lower it. And then if you feel like we have to pay for things, you then start thinking about things like rolling back accelerated depreciation for investment and those kinds of things. And the challenge down that road is it might make get rid of some of the international games that get played because we have a high rate. But if you're lowering the rate but making investment less attractive, the net effect investment could be a wash or could be even negative. Or you could go with the other strategy, which is to actually favor investment more, right? Move towards expensing rather than depreciation over time. To get rid of the silliness with the debt, you also need to pair that with limiting interest deductibility or something similar to that. You can go with that strategy. And one of the things that hasn't really, I think, been fully resolved in the business tax reform debate is which of those two routes do you want to go? Obviously, the lower the rate, broaden the base, tends to get most of the headlines. But if you're really, really focused on investment domestically, you might also think about things that try to protect or expand the incentives to invest here.
I mean, the global trend is clearly towards lower headline rates as a way of encouraging inward investment. Ireland, obviously, being one of the champions of this, does that not put an awful lot of pressure on the U.S. to follow suit, even if investment incentives might be the wiser economically?
I mean, so both the rate and the incentives matter for whether the investment happens in your country, and so in principle, you could compete on both. In practice, the rate matters enormously for all the game playing you see in the world about reallocating stuff and trying to game the rate. And you know, for that alone, and also, I mean, there's some other issues about the location of certain kinds of investment that depend on that. So there's clearly pressure to bring down the rate. We're an incredible outlier. That has to be part of the package. You know, another strategy you could go, and I have some colleagues who are doing an event on this on Friday, joint Tax Policy Center AEI event, is you might actually think that the answer to this question is that really what you need to do overall is tax corporations less in the aggregate and shift some of the tax burden on individuals, right, by doing things like raise taxes on dividends, raise taxes on capital gains, do it in a way that doesn't distort their realization behavior, focus more on taxing people who tend to be less mobile and taxing less corporations. The bumper sticker around that is kind of terrible, right? So let's cut taxes for multinationals and tax yeoman American individuals more. But from an international tax competition point of view, there's a certain logic to it that just increasingly it's difficult to tax corporations, may make sense to shift more to people.
Martin, your thoughts on corporate tax reform?
Well, Don knows the details much better than I do, so I just think with a couple of $1 trillion of corporate profits parked overseas, not wanting to come to the United States because of the high tax rate, there is at least the potential that we could bring some of that money back and use it. And we can lower I think the right thing to do is to give incentives for investment, lower the marginal tax rate, and get rid of a lot of the special provisions in our tax code that give special, you know, for the oil industry, which I don't think we need anymore. And again, he knows the details much better than I do. But I think it's very important to do if we really want to increase private investment in the United States.
Stephen.
I'm privileged. I know very little, close to nothing, about corporate taxes, let alone reforming our tax. But it presses me that the corporate tax is a foolishness. It leads to, first, the corporations don't pay it when all is said and done. It starts at a high rate and then everything disappears, so they're not paying the damn thing. Second, it generates the worst behavior you can possibly have. Everything is other than what it should be. Where we produce, what we produce, if we produce, if we just got rid of the corporate tax, zip, gone, and we put in, let's say, a value-added tax, which can generate lots of income, and it also hits imports, I may add. We're unique in the world in privileging imports in our tax situation. It might clean the field. It is such an encumbered mess that proper behavior from our economic actors is woefully distorted by the tax system. But again, I don't know anything about it.
Don, one last question, which again came up last night, which I thought was an interesting one, which is about the CBO in particular and how it scores public policy initiatives. Whether part of the reason there isn't enough innovative policy thinking going on in Congress, arguably in this area, is because if you try and score policies, they basically is just a plus and a minus against in terms of public spending, and the potential knock-on effects for the broader economy aren't visible, and therefore there isn't an incentive on Congress to be more creative. I'd be interested just to get your thoughts on that.
Sure. So, card-carrying former CBO person, think they do an enormously terrific job at a hard task. I think the first thing I would highlight is that it's the Congressional Budget Office and not the Congressional Cost-Benefit Analysis Office. And that one of the challenges is that you want policymakers to focus on all of the potential effects of a policy, not just the budget effects. But that CBO obviously is called upon as its primary responsibility to figure out what the budget effects are going to be. And they provide supplemental information when they can. Right, in the debate about health reform, they provided estimates of how many people would get insurance coverage, those kinds of things. But the core mission is to help Congress understand what the budget implications are. But you don't want members of Congress to make decisions based just on green eye shade budget implications. Right, you want them to judge what's in the best interest of the nation. And the budget can be informative of that. Right, budget matters, but you want them to take other things into account. And so there are a whole set of effects that are just going to be naturally outside the budget. There's then this issue about, well, what about the things that actually might affect the budget and do they get in there? And you know, the reality is that to the extent CBO can, or JCT, the Joint Committee on Taxation, when we're focusing on tax issues, to the extent they can, they do include the effects of investments that have direct effects on the government. Right, so there are some healthcare reforms you can make that are the basically investments, right? You make a change now, they'll have some payoff in reduced administrative costs in the future. To the extent they'll show up on the mandatory side, CBO will try to capture some of those. So they do capture some investments in there. Increasingly, they're trying to incorporate macroeconomic effects. That's primarily done for revenue proposals and for large mandatory spending issues. You've seen CBO and JCT now do that on a couple of major reform proposals. So there's some effort to get a little bit of macroeconomics in there under the rubric of dynamic scoring. You may see more. And then just, you know, There are issues about, you know, particularly in the innovation space, how can you credibly, objectively, based on evidence, connect the dots from a policy that's proposed to what you would actually include? And then you have just the budget window effect, that typically budget scores focus on the first 10 years of policy. I should note that by traditional budget standards, that's a long time, not a short time, right? We've moved from 1 year to 3 years to 5 years to 10, so view that as a plus. But there are a lot of potential things you might undertake where you would think that actually some of the payoffs are going to happen in decade two or decade three, and those are beyond the traditional focus of most CBO cost estimates, although again, in some cases, they do look beyond. So health reform is one, immigration reform is another. There's some discussion about whether they should do that more often. But, you know, but to the extent that you believe in your heart of hearts that there's some investment we could make now that would make our children better off in 15 or 20 years, I would say that's an important argument to make. You should marshal the evidence for it, but then don't blame CBO if CBO doesn't include it in a 10-year budget estimate, because that's not really the question they're being asked by the Congress.
Martin, yeah. Stephen, any thoughts on that quickly?
I mean, blaming the CBO for the deadlock in Congress is sort of a bit crazy, it seems to me. Yes, I'm sure there are things that CBO could do that would tweak their results and maybe be helpful, but CBO is a great organization. I think they've been a fantastic addition to our public policy. The problem goes much deeper in the polarized Congress and the unwillingness to, neither side sees the other. There's no cooperation. If you go back, I'm reading a biography of Harry Truman, and he had Congress against him. He was Democratic president. Congress was controlled by the Republicans, but he managed to get the Marshall Plan through. I mean, could we do something like that now? No way. So I think it's the polarization that's the problem. Maybe CBO could help a little bit, but the problem much, much deeper than that.
Okay. A little later than build, I'm going to go to the audience for questions. So as I said, there's already a few hands going up. I'll take a couple at a time. And then refer them to the panel. So right over there at the far end, the gentleman in the hat, thank you. And please do say who you are when you ask a question. Thanks.
Henry Edskowitz, Triple Helix Institute, Palo Alto. Well, we're in Washington, so of course the focus on government is the federal government. But what about the state government? Declines in R&D in the private sector at the federal level. But several years ago in California, there was a remarkable event. In response to the Bush blockage of stem cell research, the voters of California put in an initiative mandating $3 billion in bond funding for stem cell R&D, basic research, investments in firms, expected to have a payoff in 10 or even 20 years' time in health improvements in new firms. It's raised the level of the Los Angeles basin and R&D to a high level across bio because cell issues are fundamental. So, given that interest rates are low, why don't we go for deficit financing and go through the state houses, some of which will be favorable to this and some which may not? But the citizens, if you can show that there will be innovation coming out of research, which in California is entirely believable, and so the voters voted for it. And this provides what I call counter-cyclical R&D and venture capital funding. What do you think, sirs?
Thank you very much. Another question? I think there was, yes, sir, in the red tie.
Hi, Charles Westner with Georgetown University. Just a quick question. Steve, you mentioned something about trade, and I was kind of concerned that when we were talking about these investments, there was no reference to that, maybe somewhat beyond your purview. On the other hand, it seems to be having some impact on our elections. And Martin, I'm not suggesting that we should close the frontier. I just would like to know how we can respond to this growth in state mercantilist capitalism that we seem to be somewhat at loose ends on. Thank you.
Thanks. And one more, please, if there are any. Otherwise, I'll just take. Oh, yes. Adam.
Excuse me. Tobacco is taking an enormous toll on taxpayers and our economy. If we could get tobacco off the market, it would dramatically reduce healthcare expenses insurance costs, taxes, et cetera. I think we should start by reducing expenses and start with tobacco, getting that out of the market. Affects everyone's organs, smokers and non-smokers alike who are exposed to it.
Thank you very much indeed. Right, so let me ask first about state spending. Martin, could I refer that one to you, the idea that we talk endlessly about the federal government, but of course so much of public investment is actually done at a state and local level. What should states be doing?
Well, I think there is a positive response coming from states that is a response to the failure of the federal government to do what it should be doing. I think it's natural, really, if we're thinking about R&D or we're thinking about infrastructure that's interstate, that affects transportation, communication, things like that. I think the role there should be the federal government, but since the federal government isn't doing it, then I think it's great that the states are, to some extent, picking up the slack. So I applaud California, which is bigger than most other countries, for being able to do this. I don't think it's going to be an effective answer to the failures of the federal government, but at least it's a response. And my colleagues at Brookings in the Metro program, Bruce Katz, are doing a lot working with states to look for new ways to encourage investment, business investment, new ways to encourage technologies, new ways to create clusters. So a lot of that stuff is happening at the states, and it's very encouraging.
Don, any thoughts on state-level investment?
I think the same as Martin, that there's a lot of reason to think you want this at a federal level so that, so the spillovers can go to multiple states. But if the federal government isn't acting and you've got states as big as California or Texas that want to do this, there's a certain logic to that. Since I card-carrying, work at the Urban Institute, I also mentioned cities. There's an interesting governance set of issues about whether states are really the right way to look at the world or whether you should also focus on cities and regional areas, which often spread across borders. Right, so if you think about where we live right now, if you wanted to have an intelligent innovation policy for Washington, D.C., it would have to involve Washington, D.C., Maryland, and Virginia. And again, I favor federal approaches for many of these things to the extent that it's setting broad policies. But if you're thinking about things that are meant to be regionally, kind of more focused, I think you really should think about regions like that, which will sometimes be states, but sometimes not.
Steve, let me ask you about the issue of mercantilism, this idea, in a sense, that globalization is beginning to reverse politics. It seems many politicians, we needn't name any names, seem very hostile to trade. How is that affecting the productivity story and the investment story?
This is a very large question.
That's why I came to you.
Yeah, I can't handle this one in a minute or even 10. But your observation is clear. There is not just unhappiness, there is silent rage in this land and others. Feeling we've been ruined, and one source of our ruination, a big source, is opening the world economy, where all these people who earn much less than I can possibly live on can compete with me, and frankly, using the same tools. This is a formula to create considerable unhappiness. Just as opening borders to mass migration can create considerable unhappiness. Now, it is unclear how much shelter from the rest of the world a democracy needs. I have no idea, let alone a quantitative estimate. But these are questions that we have in the last while carefully hidden ourselves from. I know of no reputable wrestling with these questions.
Oh come on. There's lots of wrestling with these questions.
They're trade
questions. For one thing, every advanced economy, including the ones with trade surpluses like Germany, are seeing a decline in the share of manufacturing jobs in their economy. And the rate of decline is pretty much the same across all the advanced economies. the rate of decline of manufacturing jobs from 1945 to 1955 or to 1960 is about the same as it was after that. So manufacturing jobs, the share of total jobs, are going to decline whether you open up or whether you don't open
right.
up. So let's
we
keep
agree.
This thing in perspective.
We agree on that.
Well, okay. But that's not what I took you...
No, no. Manufacturing has had the very great advantage of steadily increasing productivity
exactly.
and producing more with less.
Yes.
Steadily for a long, long time. Manufacturing as a proportion of value added is a slightly different story. But I'm not making a case for manufacturing. I thought I did a good job on that in 1987.
Manufacturing matters.
Yes, I thought it was...
Classic book.
I hate to say it. I thought it was close enough to being right as things go in this sort of a world. that it worth it. But I'm just addressing the seriousness of the question and offering no solutions. The assumption, you know, projective thinking that, you know, we'll do an open economy and the other guys will come around to it. And they probably will after the two or three generations of using the model pioneered, let's say, by Germany, but really pioneered by Japan and then superscaled by China. And second, the movements of people. I don't know. I think it was Mao Zedong who famously suggested that he would send 10 million people if Nixon wanted them. And there are real problems. Europe is falling apart on this question.
That you know, the presence of Hispanics in the United States is what's undermining, nope. is causing our ruination.
I'm not hinting at anything.
Wrong.
I'm saying the people feel they are being ruined. They're looking to see what the hell is ruining them.
Okay.
The traditional answer is them. Whoever the hell somebody can point them at.
We're getting slightly away from productivity and investment, however. Although it's obviously a fascinating topic. Let's get some more questions from the audience. Please try and keep them to productivity, investment. Madam here, thank you.
Linda Schmidt, Trade and Services International. I think this is a very good point, and I think it comes down to what you were talking about, investment in infrastructure. How is investment in infrastructure in the United States important to our open trade stance? We have a very open trade stance, but we are not investing domestically when we're competing with countries with like China. So how can you link the two things or rationalize that we have got to do a much better job of investing in infrastructure to support our open trade stance?
Thank you. Any more in this round?
Arvind Krishna, IBM. So, Stephen, you mentioned a number of examples, whether it was across toll roads, it was across railways, subways, which in practice are regulated monopolies, and in practice give a guaranteed return. Should there be more such projects created by the federal government?
Thanks. Any more? One more in this round? Right, over here. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Hi, Andrew Reamer, George Washington University. Question for Stephen. Between the Civil War and the Depression, the Republican Party had the presidency, except for two presidents, for Grover Cleveland and for Woodrow Wilson. And over that period of time, there was a lot of... the federal government had an industrial policy that was worked out in large part in collaboration with corporations. So there, in addition to tariffs, there were investments in federal laboratories, there was the development of the National Bureau of Standards, and the creation of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. So there was this confluence of interest between the federal government and major corporations in the U.S., which doesn't seem to exist today. So the question for you is, why was there this intersection of interests 150 years ago, and it's not there today?
Thanks. Steve, let's start with that one then. That's an interesting question, looking back on your research. Maybe pull in this whole issue of regulated monopolies as well.
And the little intellectual model I was offering of government opening a new space and doing what's needed to get entrepreneurial activity in there. And entrepreneurs don't always have to be two guys in a garage. They can be a railway company. In the book, Brad and I likened it to tigers mating. They don't have to hang around for very long and cuddle, but they get the task done. There is this moment of cooperation. And I'm not sure government is more hostile or business more hostile to government now. The rhetoric is higher because the rhetoric is higher, but it seems to me they're terribly hand in glove. So I don't see, but I may just be perceiving the current situation differently from you, and my perceptions are not particularly better than anybody else's in that matter.
Martin, any thoughts on that one?
I'm sorry, I was thinking back a little bit on the others.
We came back. One of the questioners came back to this point of open trade and investment, which I think and raised a good point, which is investment seems to be going abroad rather than to the U.S. in the context of open trade. How do we ensure that there is the domestic investment that people want to see?
Well, investment in the United States has to be attractive, and part of that is taxes. Part of that is making sure we have a supply of skilled workers. We need to do a much better job there. And otherwise, I think investing in the United States can be attractive, and we can do that if we have the right tools in place. And I think improving our infrastructure contributes to that too. So I think that's another way in which we become more competitive. So I think doing the right things in terms of our tax policy, our infrastructure policy, training policy, those are the things that will make investment in the United States more attractive again.
Don, let me turn it to you as well. Finally, how do we ensure that the U.S. is an attractive place to invest? What are the key points that you think this audience should take away in terms of making this a place where companies want to actually put their money to work?
You would usually take it for granted in the United States, but given some certain political winds out there, it may not be quite as for granted at the moment, right? So a stable rule of law is kind of thing one, which I hope will persist. But seriously, right, so obviously, I mean, there's all the tax things, whatever. I think I would particularly pick up on the point that Martin made about a skilled workforce. I think it's stunning to me how many Americans still to this day can graduate from high school and still be lagging in basic skills around literacy and numeracy. And that's just a major stain on our nation. We ought to figure out a way to, you know, and I don't pretend this is easy, but there have been innovations in thinking about how you can design training programs that can combine kind of take folks where they are, build them some skills, right? We should do more on apprenticeships. We should do more on work training programs that actually work. We should think about work training programs that are paired with private sector employers so that you're training people for jobs that actually exist. And I think there's a suite of policies in that space that are important to pursue. So when you look both domestically and abroad and say America is a great place to invest, it's not just that we have firm rule of law, good tax policy, turns out lots of natural gas, but also we have a great labor force at all levels, right? In addition to high-skilled folks, it's really important that we're able to say we have a very large and great middle-skill workforce, and there's a lot more to be done on that front.
Last point to you, Stephen. Your book is pretty optimistic, I think, in the end. It talks about the invisible hand having been repeatedly lifted by the government in the past. I presume that would be your point, that the government does have a role in lifting the government, the invisible hand, and steering it in certain directions.
Well, either this government is going to help redirect the U.S. economy, or some other governments will. Still, perhaps mostly by inertia, if not sound judgment, I'd just as soon it were this government.
Martin, last point to you.
I think there's a lot of innovation out there. I think there's a lot of entrepreneurial energy out there. So I would be optimistic that we do have the right ingredients. These are kind of difficult times, and I have let my emotions get the better of me a little bit here. These are difficult political times and obviously tragic times in some respects. But sort of coming back to the economics of it, I think the U.S. actually is a very attractive place to invest, has a lot of talent and a lot of innovation. And so I'm optimistic that we will get that productivity growth, if not next year, within the next several years.
Well, I think that's a great note to end it on. Certainly in my travels around the U.S. since I arrived here, I've seen extraordinary innovation, especially really in some of these big centers, biotech, science, all the rest of it. It's been really staggering. So I would share that optimism and ask everyone to join me in thanking Martin, Stephen, and Donald. Thanks very much.